So now we give the floor to Nuwan. Yes, who will talk about delivering the modern APIs. Know what it takes. Thank you.
Hi. I guess thanks for coming. So my name is Nuwan. I am Professor Senior Director of API Architects at WSO2. Let me give a couple of seconds for the people to walk in. Okay, so let's get started. So I'll quickly introduce myself. So that's basically my Twitter handle. You can go and follow me if you like me. I work as a product manager for the WSO2 API manager. So that's basically an open source API management solution, about 7 years old now in the market, and it's a fully open source solution that comes with an Apache 2 license. I'm an architect at heart, so I love building software, using architecture to solve complex problems, and needless to say, I love APIs. And lately, I've been working on this book, and I've completed most of the work of it. So it's the co-author of the book called Microservices Security in Action. So I'm doing this with one of my colleagues, Prabhat, at work, and with Manny. So the book will hopefully be out in a couple of months. It's in early access edition. You can go and have a preview of it as well. So that's about me. And in terms of work, I'm mainly responsible for the R&D and all of the management and of the WSO2 API manager as a product. So today I'll be talking about what it takes to deliver a modern API. So I'll be using my experiences and the things that I've learned talking with different customers and being in the industry for some time to talk about what it takes to deliver a modern API in the current context of the world. So we've been, I'm pretty sure you've been hearing a lot of things during this conference and in previous conferences about various technologies, practices, architectures, vendors, solutions, and so on. But the most important thing we have to keep in mind is when we learn these things and whatever we implement, we have one goal in mind. And that goal is to deliver value to our customers, whether we use microservices, monoliths, mainframes, or whatever we use to deliver our software as digital enterprises. Our number one priority is to give value to our customers. So that's something that should always be on the back of our minds. So what does that mean? What that means is you need to do lots of things, experiments and stuff to figure out what is it that exactly gives values to your customers, right? So Microsoft did a cool experiment several years ago about about the rate of success of the things that you do that actually give value to our customers. And they found out that only about 30% of the things that enterprises do by themselves really give the expected value. That means like two-thirds of the things that we as vendors or you as providers of software do by yourselves are a failure. Right, so what that means is we need to be able to build platforms that allow us to deploy things fast, see how they work, see how users adopt them, and then change course as necessary. Right, so that's basically why microservice architectures and things like this are becoming fundamentally important, because in the context of the current world, in the competition that we are dealing with, we have to put things out in the market, see how they work, roll back on failures, make course corrections, and so on, right? And that's one of the fundamental reasons why microservice and distributed platforms are becoming popular and common now. So that's basically leading us into an era of a trillion endpoints. That's what's happening in the world, right? Now, if you look at back in the day where we had monolith business applications, and then we moved on into enterprise applications, and then departmental apps, where we had apps by departments, and then we moved on into like in the 2000s, into the SaaS world, into the world of SaaS, into the world of internet. And in the first decade, like we used about, we talked about, we completed in the second decade actually about public and private APIs, and now we are completing the second decade of the 21st century. And what this is leading us moving forward into the third decade of the century is into a heavily distributed serverless microservice kind of architectures and deployment patterns. So this is basically where we are heading towards. So we are heading towards an era of where there will be a huge number of services and heterogeneous types of services that we will be dealing with in our enterprise applications as well. So what does it mean to APIs? Right? So we are here to talk all about APIs. So you can think of APIs as a circuit board, right? So all of the things that you're doing in terms of modernizing architectures and building new stuff is like the back end of this, right? So you'll have lots of, you know, lots of equipment, connectors talking to each other, various complex protocols and so on, right? And this will only get complicated and grown. However, the way you deliver these capabilities to the outside world is going to be through a very clean, clear interface, which is what we call as APIs. So that's basically how we use the power of all of these technologies that we are building and distributing and exposing them into the outside world in the form of APIs. So this is how I see APIs playing a very critical role in the coming years, in the years to come, right? So how we have been doing most of API management for so long is using workflows that represent kind of this workflow. So we've been doing design and documentation of APIs, starting from UIs and stuff, right? Going into lifecycle management and publishing our APIs, and then, you know, people coming in and discovering our APIs through portals again, and then application developers building apps on top of those APIs. So this has been the traditional model of how we have delivered APIs so far into the market, right? Now, this is not going to cut it in the years to come, right? If you look at how you develop microservices, what you do when you develop microservices is that you start from code, you commit it into a repository, you engage CI/CD into your services, into your code, and that's basically how you deliver your microservices. Now, if you want to make your APIs as innovative as your services, you basically have to adopt the same kind of pattern for your API development as well. So what that basically means is you build, deploy, test your APIs first. So you engage, you start from code, you engage into your source repositories just like with any other piece of software. You engage CI/CD from day one, you iterate on these, right? And then move on, once you're happy with how the API behavior is, you move on into the documentation, publishing, and finally consuming it. So this I call as a bottom-up mechanism of delivering APIs as opposed to a UI-first driven approach. Fundamentally, end of the day, we do the same thing, but the way we do it, how we do it, has to change if we are to be better at delivering these capabilities. So why I put not SOA in here is because it's important that we learn from the SOA world, from the SOA era, and look at things what we could have done better from the SOA era and make sure we apply those in our new development. So one of the things that SOA did was, like, the SOA was pushed down by vendors a lot, right? There were a lot of vendors who were pushing down how you should be doing service-oriented architectures using various their technologies. But when it comes to APIs, you should always give prominence to developers, right? The freedom of choice to choose their own programming languages, mechanisms, practices, and that is basically what will make microservices successful. That is what has made microservices successful, and that will what will make APIs successful as well. Now, when you adopt these kinds of practices, there are things that you have to think about, right? What are you missing on? Right? And one of the things that you may think that you're missing on is governance. So it's really cool and fine to, you know, give our teams and developers the freedom that they want. But something that we should always keep in mind, that we are doing all of these things, like I mentioned in the beginning, is towards a common goal, right? We need to make this alignment happen, right? We need to have a clear direction of where we are heading towards, plus have a way to verify that we are heading towards that direction. How do we do this for our APIs, right? And this is where the concept of the control plane and the data plane becomes very, very important, right? So if you think of APIs and API management solutions, so what operates in the data plane are your workloads. So you will basically have your services and your API runtimes in the data plane. Now, in order to control, or rather make sure that all of these are aligned towards your business objectives, which is to provide value to your customers, you need a mechanism to govern these, to govern your workloads, to make sure that they are aligned with your like security policies in your organization, the standards in your organization, so on and so forth. And that is why the value of an API management platform becomes invaluable, that operates in the control plane and controls all of how your APIs are tuned and targeted towards delivering the value that we want to, right? So that's fundamentally how like an API management system becomes important and distributed as well. So as you can see, they are not in the same layer. You have the controls in the control layer and your workloads in the data layer. So if you API gateways, micro gateways, all of those should be clearly separated from your management layer and independent as well. Another important thing about modern APIs is that they are no longer a simple proxy to your microservices, right? APIs are no longer a simple proxy to your microservices. They are composable units, are programmable units that you deploy into your data plane. So what does that mean? Now, if you think of a typical microservice architecture, right, you will have a heterogeneous collection of microservices. They can be like simple HTTP microservices, some can be gRPC microservices, some, you can have serverless functions that cater your business requirements, message queues. These are a heterogeneous collection of microservices that you will end up with, right? But you can't expose all of these, you know, as is to the consuming world, like the circuit board. You don't expose all of those as independent connectors, right? You compose them into a single unit, which can be a generalized form, right? So that is why composability of APIs is also going to be a critical requirement moving forward. Because so far we've been dealing with mostly a single type of APIs, but now it's getting a lot heterogeneous. If you look at modern applications, these apps are heavily heterogeneous because of the nature of the services that they consume. So composability of APIs is going to be a critically important factor as well. And so you probably heard a lot of things on API security during this conference and in previous conferences as well. So I want to take a higher level view on the security of APIs. So it's highly probable that you've been hearing a lot about the number two here, the identity and access management layer, which is where protocols like OAuth2, authorization specifications, things like, you know, the open API agent and the open policy agent, things come in, right? But what you should now be looking at is API security goes well beyond the authentication and authorization, right? So authentication and authorization covers one aspect of it, but there are various other aspects to think as well. So one of them is malicious content. Right, so I see threats in the form of malicious content. So you should have mechanisms of detecting malicious content. So even if you have authenticated credentials, you should have built-in mechanisms that prevent malicious content in the form of payloads and, you know, other stuff like things like SQL injections, XSS attacks that can happen on your system, right? And second thing, of course, authentication and authorization, which I won't go into the details. I'm sure you've heard a lot about this stuff during this conference. And the third most important thing is things that you can't detect through content inspection or through authentication and authorization. Basically, what happens when your system is hacked and people try to derive data. So this is where machine learning and the observations of and learnings of patterns becomes critically important. So you also need to have mechanisms built in that learn the normal behavior of your systems, and that can, you know, trigger alerts and various kinds of other mechanisms when an abnormality is detected, right? So for example, if you have a token that's coming in from Paris, and 1 hour later, if the same token is coming in from, let's say, somewhere else, from the US, that's an indication of something's not right, because a person can't travel from Paris to US within a span of 1 hour, right? So the, you need systems that are able to detect these kinds of capabilities using things like artificial intelligence, machine learning, and similar mechanisms. So that's on the angle of the security of APIs. And another important aspect is scale. So how we do architectures in the modern world is like, so you may have noticed now, enterprises are now moving on into cloud-native architectures. Enterprises are moving their workloads into the cloud. So what does that mean? Moving to the cloud doesn't come for free, right? So how we used to do architectures, like capacity planning for architectures, is that we used to identify the peak load requirements on the system, and then we used to do a capacity plan that can cover that peak and multiply it by 2 so that we have high availability. That's basically how we used to do capacity planning. But now when we are moving our workloads into the cloud, that is not optimal because it costs you a lot, right? If you are to operate every day for a capacity that you're only going to need 5% of the time, right? That means you're paying 95% of the time, you're overpaying, right? You're not optimizing your costs. So what does that mean? That means you need to be able to run workloads 95% of the time in average and scale up and down as and when required. That is basically what will optimize your resources, right? So you just need to consider these factors and plus a lot more when thinking about scale of your system. You need to think about how fast, what's the latency being added by these layers, right? Are they considerable, are they not? Right? What's the boot up delay? If you want 5 more services, how long does it take for you to boot up those 5 services, right? If it's taking 10 minutes, you are going to be a bit in trouble, right? And what's the level of independence and isolation? Now, if you want to scale an API, and if you want to, when scaling that API, if you had to scale 5 other things to support that scale of the API, then again, you're going to, it's going to be harder, right? Not that it's going to be impossible, but it's going to be harder. So the more independent it is, the easier it is going to be for you to scale. And what happens when it comes to the replication of state? So stateless systems are usually pretty easy to scale. You don't have to think about the replicating the state because the systems are stateless. But if the system is stateful, you need to now think about what does it take for you to replicate the state when you are scaling up and down your system. So these are again important factors to think about when architecting for modern architectures. A critically important thing is availability, right? So the entire human race is looking for availability, right? And that's why we are looking for water in Mars, so that, you know, when Earth goes down, we can move to Mars and live some time, allow Earth to heal, and come back to Earth after we've screwed up Mars, right? So that's basically why availability is important, right? Availability is critically important because in the modern world, the 9's availability is slowly dying off, right? So we've been talking about 9's availability, 3 9's, 4 9's availability for a long period of time, but now you know what happens, right? So if something goes down, and you know someone tweets about it, right? Someone retweets it. You may have your systems up and running in 5 minutes, but even 1 hour later, the entire world thinks your systems are down and crashed, right? So availability is critically important in the modern world. So what are the things to think about? So one of the most important things is how fast can you recover when something goes wrong. It's obviously very good to design systems that don't go down, but the reality is at some point in time, things will go down, right? So you need to think about when it goes down, how do I recover, and how fast can I recover? So you know, these are things that are important to think about. And also resiliency, like data centers, in which data centers do I run, and how do I have a highly available second data center that can take things up if my primary data center goes down. And also, as I said, a lot of systems are now moving to cloud, right? So what if there's an issue in cloud, right? How do I make sure my customers are not affected in case a certain service in a certain cloud provider goes down, right? So these are again important things to think about. So you need to have capabilities where you can run across cloud, right? And maybe some workloads on-prem in your data centers in case something goes wrong. So again, these are things like availability are critically important for you to think about. And so let me make this statement, because I think it's pretty important. The future of APIs and API management is going to be hybrid. To me, there's no argument on this. It's very clear. So if you look at modern applications, right, you have workloads spread across various systems, right? You may have like some workloads on-prem, maybe running on platforms like Kubernetes, some serverless functions, right? Some running on, like, let's say Google Cloud, right? Some services running on AWS, right? So if you think of an organization, an enterprise, the larger you are, the more distributed your workloads are going to become, right? They are going to be spread across various systems. So when you are looking for an API system, you need to think of whether and how you can run these in a hybrid architecture. And when I say hybrid, it's not just the infrastructure hybridness, but also the software and the service hybridness, right? Can you integrate across various functions, run on different platforms, and so on and so forth, right? And finally, what's another thing that's critically important is the insights. So when you deploy a system, so I started the session by saying it's critically important that we have this goal in mind that we deliver value to our customers. So insights is a way that we can measure ourselves on whether we are really getting there. So there are different types of insights we can gather from APIs and that we should gather from APIs. One is, of course, the operational insights, just to make sure everything is running fine, the responses are coming in fast enough, and also capabilities to diagnose errors when they happen, like whether you can trace down when something goes wrong to the root cause and how fast you can do that. And also the business insights to evaluate whether what you are doing really aligns with the business objectives, right? So you need to basically reevaluate yourselves at certain time periods to make sure that your APIs are delivering the value that your business is really looking for. So that's basically a summary that brings me to the end of my session. So in a summary, delivering value to our customers is our number one priority, always, whatever we do. And transitioning into a decentralized architecture, microservices-like architecture, is the way to do that. So modern APIs, I believe, should be developed bottom-up, giving more prominence to developers and architects rather than being pushed down through vendors. The control plane is basically the way to govern our APIs and make sure they meet our organizational objectives. APIs should be composable, and when thinking about security, you have to think much more than authentication and authorization now. You have to think about scale, availability, and use insights as a measure of measuring that your APIs are delivering the business value that you intend. So that brings me to the end of my session. So I just have about 30 seconds more, so I'm not going to use it for questions. But I'll be downstairs. We have a booth downstairs. So in case you have any questions or want to talk to myself or one of my team, please do come downstairs. and meet us. We'll be there for the rest of the day. Thank you so much for attending. I hope it has been useful.